Good morning, everyone. Come in, find a seat, get yourself settled in. I love it. I need to go down just a little bit. I love it how you guys visit like this. I think fellowship is a key part of what happens here at the church, and I always love to see this happen each morning. So welcome. My name is Tim Simonson. For those who do not know me, I am one of the elders here at the church, and it is a pleasure to see all of you here. Couple things to make you aware of. This coming Friday night is another one of the movie nights that is planned. It's a time for fellowship. It's a time to have more of the same conversation. And it's also a time to eat spaghetti. Scott, I believe, is probably putting that together. So spaghetti meal ahead of that is going to be Friday at 6 o'clock this coming Friday in the fellowship hall. The movie we're watching is called Overcomer. It's a Christian film. It's built around the theme of a coach and some issues that he goes through, as well as some of his athletes. Should be a great movie to enjoy. So come and do that this Friday night at 6 o'clock. Also coming up on the May 14th is the Women's Missionary Fellowship. We'll be meeting again, WMF. The goal of WMF is to pray for our missionaries. That's a key piece of what they do, as well as the same fellowship happening in those smaller group, as well as the work on projects. So on May 14th at 10 in the morning, WMF will be meeting. So if you can be a part of that, by all means, do that. As we transition to worship, it's critical that we get our hearts right. And therefore, the purpose of a call to worship, the purpose is to draw us into that place and allow God to do that. So join with me as we read together the call to worship from Psalm. Perfect. So all together, God, you are my God. I eagerly seek you. I thirst for you. My body faints for you in a land that is dry, desolate, and without water. So I gaze on you in the sanctuary to see your strength and your glory. My lips will glorify you because of your faithful love is better than life. So I will bless you as long as I live. At your name, I will lift up my hands. Heavenly Father, would you help us to do that this morning? Would you help us to clear our minds of the things that would distract you from you in any way? And Lord, would you speak to us? Would you, by your power, by your spirit, would you work within our hearts and our minds so that we can see you this morning? In Jesus' name, amen.
Please stand as we worship. And this first song we're going to sing is Creating Me a Clean Heart. And it is directly from Scripture. It's a Psalm of David. And in the chorus, it says, cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Now, as followers of Jesus, we will not be cast away from the presence of God, and he will not take our Holy Spirit from us. However, we're singing scripture this morning, so I just wanted to share that. Create in me a clean heart, oh God, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, oh God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, oh Lord, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, oh God, and renew a right spirit within me. Create in me a clean heart, oh God, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and renew a right spirit within me. Cast me not away from thy presence, O Lord, and take not thy Holy Spirit from me. Restore unto me the joy of thy salvation, and renew a right spirit within me.
Good morning. This week's New City Catechism is question number 39. Last week we asked, what is prayer? This week we look into our attitude towards prayer. And it comes from Philippians 4:6. Do not be anxious about anything, but in everything, by prayer and supplication, with thanksgiving, let your requests be made known to God. So the question this week is, with what attitude should we pray? And if you can repeat with me the answer, with love, perseverance, and gratefulness, in humble submission to God's will, knowing that for the sake of Christ, he always hears our prayers. Before we pray, I just want you to, let's bow our heads and think about, as Tim said, as we come to worship God, let's think about first the thankfulness that we have with him. So let's just, in prayer right now, just think about how thankful you are that God is in our lives. Loving Father, we come to you in the name of your beloved Son. Give us perseverance in prayer, even when we do not immediately see answers. Let us believe that you will not keep back any good thing from us, and trust that you will withhold those things we seek that would harm us. Your ways are higher than our ways, and we entrust our requests to your sovereign kindness. Amen.
Please stand as we continue to worship.
Here, on holy ground, here. Jesus, you brought heaven's sound. My sin was greater, love was greater. What could separate us now? What a wonderful name it is. What a wonderful name it is. The name of Jesus Christ, light.
My microphone is dead, so I'm going to use the pulpit mic. Good morning, everybody. Welcome. For those of you who are new with us, my name is Adam, and I am the teaching pastor here. As most of you noticed, the handsome worship leader, Mark, is not here, so you guys have to suffer with looking at this for the next few weeks. He's on vacation, so continue to lift him and Sally up in prayer. For travel mercies, for safety, for respite, and just that God would bring them back to us. But before we get too far today, I would like to acknowledge something very important. That is, a week from today, this coming Sunday, is Mother's Day. So make sure you take care of these special moms in your life. And as Tim puts batteries in this for me, I want you to know, husbands, that has been your warning. You do something for your wife and for your mom. Okay, today we're going to look at John chapter 6, verses 1 through 21. It is actually the longest chapter in the New Testament, but we're not going to get through the whole thing today. It's going to take us a few weeks. First, I'm going to read the scripture, then we're going to pray, and then we will jump into the message. Thank you, Tim. Look at that. That was quick. Round of applause for Tim. All right. John chapter 6. After this, Jesus went away to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias. And a large crowd followed him, because they saw the signs that he was doing on the sick. Jesus went up on the mountain, and there he sat down with his disciples. Now, the Passover, the feast of the Jews, was at hand. Lifting up his eyes, Then, and seeing that a large crowd was coming toward him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread so that these people may eat?" He said this to test him, for he himself knew what he would do. Philip answered him, 200 denarii worth of bread would not be enough for each of them to get a little. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There is a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish. But what are they for so many?" And Jesus said, "Have the people sit down." Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down, about 5,000 in number. Jesus then took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated. So also the fish, as much as they wanted. And when they had gathered, or when they had eaten their fill, he told his disciples, "Gather up the leftover fragments, that nothing may be lost." So they gathered them up and filled 12 baskets with fragments from the 5 barley loaves left by those who had eaten. When the people saw the sign that he had done, they said, "This indeed is the prophet who is to come into the world." Perceiving then that they were about to come and take him by force and make him king, Jesus withdrew again to the mountain by himself. When evening came, his disciples went down to the sea and got into a boat and started across the sea to Capernaum. It was now dark, and Jesus had not yet come to them. The sea became rough because a strong wind was blowing. When they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and coming near the boat, and they were frightened. But he said to them, "It is I, do not be afraid." Then they were glad to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat was at the land to which they were going. This is God's word. Let's pray. Father, we come before you this morning, Lord, and we are so thankful that you have provided Jesus for us so that we can have a relationship for you. We are thankful for your word in which it's showing us this morning that you give abundantly and you rescue us. Lord, help us to remember those things each day, each moment of our lives. And Lord, in this moment, as we hear your word proclaimed, Lord, we want your Holy Spirit to do an amazing and mighty work in our hearts. Lord, we want you to help us to be more like Jesus. We want to grow close in relationship to you, and we cannot do that in our own strength. It takes you. And Lord, this morning, we ask that you would convict us, help us to see where we're not trusting you as our safety. And Lord, we pray for those who are here this morning who may not know you. Lord, we ask that today would be the day that they would put faith in Jesus for the forgiveness of sins. So, Lord, bless our time and do your work here at FBC Ashland in our hearts and through us. And we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. If there is one thing that I have learned in all the wisdom that God has given me, it is that, for the most part, the male sense of humor peaks at about the age of 12. Listen, maybe not all men, but most men. If you have ever been on an only guys camping trip, there does not seem to be any discrepancy in age for what guys find funny. And usually it involves a bodily function that involves the release of methane gas. It does not matter how educated, how old, or what these people have done, these men, they all find the release of methane gas to be simply hilarious, which is probably why I really like a show called Impractical Jokers. It involves these 4 guys who have been best friends since high school and have been playing jokes on each other since high school. The gist of the show is that they all have to do what the other guys tell them they have to do, no matter how embarrassing it is. And if they refuse to do it, they lose. And whoever racks up the most losses in a given episode, they get punished, and now they have to do something either very embarrassing or very scary. I've seen them make one of the guys who's afraid of sharks dive in a shark tank in the ocean, the little cage that's supposedly protecting you from those killer things. They've done all sorts of things to these guys. So they get punishment, and they cannot refuse their punishment via their contract for the television show. And in one of the season finales, they were trying to raise money for causes for charity. And each one of them picked a different nonprofit. And whoever won the challenge, it meant that $50,000 would go to that person's choice of nonprofit. Well, being that they're all reasonable human beings, they all have a fear of heights. And the challenge was a 5-story-high tightrope walk. And these guys are not exactly what one would call athletic. In fact, 3 of them are noticeably overweight. 2 of them got to be wearing a double extra large. So they go, and there's this tall 5-story tightrope. And as you can imagine, a tightrope walk is not easy for the athletically skilled. It's not going to be easy for these 4 completely average middle-aged dudes. Whoever goes the furthest is the one that gets the charity. They don't even have to complete the tightrope walk. Just whoever goes the furthest would win. Now, they did not have a catch-all safety net underneath them, but they did have a harness attached to them so that if they fell, actually when they fell, it would stop their fall and let them down gently and slowly to the 5 stories below. The first of the 3 guys got 5 feet in, 9.2 feet in, and 9.7 feet in, respectively, before falling. The 4th guy, though, in a magical and miraculous feat of physical prowess, even though he appeared as if he was failing a sobriety test while he was walking on that tightrope, he did manage to walk all 20 feet across this thin wire and win the money for his charity. But the point is, they were never going to be okay if they did not have that safety harness. At least 3 of them would have died without that safety harness. That safety harness even made it where the TV show could continue, because without the other 3 guys, there's no TV show. It's hard to play a practical joke on yourself. And Jesus is the safety harness for us as we walk the tightrope of life. And we're all going to fall off that tightrope at some point. And the consequence of sin is that pavement 5 stories below. But if we have put on the safety harness, the literal armor of God, through faith in Jesus when he gives us his righteousness, through our faith in him for the forgiveness of sins, we don't go smush when we fall. Instead, we get to be in the presence of Jesus for eternity. You've just learned 2 things. 1, I have the sense of humor of a 12-year-old, and 2, Jesus is our safety harness. So a little bit of context here. Last week, we looked at John 5:19 through 47. And in that, Jesus was having a conversation with the religious elites, the Pharisees, who were mad at him for healing someone on the Sabbath. And we learned from that conversation that Jesus, as God the Son, has all authority. We learned that Jesus is so relationally connected to the Father that he always knows what the Father is doing, and he's always doing what the Father is doing. And because of that, and in his willingness to be the sacrifice for our sins, God the Father has given Jesus all authority, so that at the name of Jesus, every knee should bow and every mouth confess that he is God. Jesus has all authority, and he will be glorified by all. In that conversation Jesus had with the men who rejected him, we also found out that it is Jesus who grants eternal life, because no one comes to the Father except through the Son. And remember, we talked about how as Jesus, God the Son, is the messenger of God the Father. And culturally, if the sender of a message sent a messenger, and especially their own son, it was expected that the party receiving the message would take in that messenger as if the person sending the message was physically present with them. It would be treating the Son exactly as you would treat the Father. And what we learned was that those who reject the Son reject the Father as well. And Jesus made that very clear to the religious elite, that their rejection of him was to literally reject the Father. But that acceptance of the Son meant acceptance of the Father. And the Son is the means to eternal life, and accepting him means putting faith in him for the forgiveness of sins through his works in his life, death, burial, and resurrection, and being freely given eternal life. But Jesus did not just stop there. He also told them, look, I get this is hard for you to understand, so let me tell you about these witnesses who are proclaiming about me. John the Baptist, who you kind of accepted a little bit for a short time and never really told everybody you didn't believe him, he proclaimed about me. The Father himself proclaims about me through his word, the word of God, the works that I do also proclaim about me, the miracles. And since these men claimed that they believe in Moses, he told them where Moses proclaimed about Jesus in the Old Testament in Deuteronomy chapter 18. And through that, we learned that they should have accepted Jesus. But we can also see how many witnesses point to Jesus for ourselves as we look back at the word of God, at what Jesus did, and even looking back at our own life and the transformation that he has brought us from who we used to be to who we are now through Jesus. Now, in the beginning of the scripture this morning, beginning of chapter 6, it says, and after this. And we know that through this scripture this morning, this was Passover. And we know the events from last chapter were during another Jewish feast, which means that between the two scriptures, from chapter 5 to chapter 6, at least 6 months had passed, because that would have been the nearest other Jewish feast closest to the Passover. So from chapter 5 to chapter 6, there has been at least 6 months. And John doesn't detail whatever happened in those 6 months because it's not needed for what he's trying to communicate. And what he is trying to communicate is what the other three Gospels had not communicated about Jesus yet. And today we're going to see two major miracles. One of them, the feeding of the 5,000, and the second is Jesus walking on water. And what those two miracles communicate is something that every human being desires, and that is safety, which is why my big idea this morning is Jesus is our safety. Jesus is our safety. Let me explain that. There are two main categories we look at when looking for safety. One is provision, and two is avoidance of life-threatening danger. So think about it. We don't feel safe when we do not have what we need to be provided for. We don't feel safe when we know we don't have enough food in the fridge. We don't feel safe when we don't have enough resources. We don't know where we're going to get our next meal from. And we don't feel safe even if we are provided for, but unforeseen circumstances take place in our life in which it threatens something about our independence, whether it's our physical independence or our financial independence. We don't feel safe when those circumstances happen. We in Southern Oregon don't feel safe when fires are ravaging through the valley. We wouldn't feel safe if it were floods or tornadoes or a volcano. I just thought of that one. And it distracted me. And for some, an unforeseen circumstance has left them without provision. There are people in here who know what it's like to lose their home to a fire, right? Or to lose their business to a fire. But as we look at the scripture today, we see Jesus is our safety. Because if we have put faith in him for the forgiveness of sins, we can know that he is going to give us the provision we need. Because we see him miraculously feed the 5,000. Now, it does not at all mean that there will not be times in our lives where we will be physically without. But it does mean that for what he has called us to, he will provide. And the main thing he has called all of us to is a relationship with himself. And that relationship with him will be abundant. He will provide for all of our spiritual needs, and he will abundantly provide eternal life if we have put faith in Jesus for the forgiveness of sins. And we're going to find out more next week what that means and how he tells us how he is the bread of life. But let's think about our true need. Our true need is for relationship with God. Our true need is for eternal life. And we can't do anything, nothing in our own strength to get there. We can't work ourselves into righteousness. We cannot make ourselves holy. Jesus, God the Son, has provided that through his sinless life, through his taking on our punishment for our sins, and through his resurrection showing us his power to give eternal life. Jesus has provided abundantly. But are we going to accept that abundant provision, or are we going to reject it? And as far as danger from unforeseen circumstances, he rescues us from it. Not always physically, but if we have put faith in Jesus, always spiritually. In fact, Jesus in his ministry is telling everyone what the true unforeseen circumstance is, and that is separation from God because of our sin. The whole of Israel thought they were good by just trying to do their best to keep the law. But it wasn't about keeping the law. The law was there to show them they couldn't measure up to God's standard of holiness. And they just didn't see that. And so the plan was that God himself, God the Son, would put on flesh, become fully man, live the life we couldn't, take the punishment too costly for us to bear, and provide relationship to God by giving us his own righteousness when we put faith in him. He is rescuing us from the unforeseen circumstance by providing his righteousness abundantly to us when we put faith in him for the forgiveness of sins. That is why my first point this morning is Jesus provides abundantly. Jesus provides abundantly. And again, that is not to say there will not be times when we feel like we are without, and even times where we are physically without provision. And trust me, as we can see from Scripture today, God does care about the physical, but he is much more concerned about spiritual provision. For what good does it do if we gain the whole world yet lose our soul? What good does it do if we never have a physical need in this life, but our spiritual needs are not met? And our spiritual need is this: we can't do anything in our own strength to make our relationship right with God. So God has provided that through the works of Jesus. No one can say that Jesus is not enough for us to be redeemed if we put faith in him. He has bought us back from our sins because he has paid the payment for our sins, providing us a way to relationship with God. So let's get into the scripture here. Verse 1, chapter 6. After this, Jesus went away to the other side of the Sea of Galilee, which is the Sea of Tiberias. Again, after this means at least 6 months has passed since that conversation he had with the religious elite of John chapter 5. He's left Jerusalem and he went north to the Sea of Galilee. And it says also known as the Sea of Tiberias. Now there was a town called Tiberias on the shore, one of the shores of Galilee. And it was named after the Roman emperor Tiberius. But because John said that the Sea of Galilee was also known as the Sea of Tiberias, we can actually know that John literally did write his gospel later after the three synoptic gospels of Matthew, Mark, and Luke. And that's exactly what church tradition tells us, that church leaders approached John and said, hey, we have these three gospels, but we know you were really close to Jesus, and we'd like you to write a fourth gospel. That's what church tradition tells us, and that's what the scripture points to in that the Sea of Tiberias wasn't called the Sea of Tiberias until around AD 70, which would have been after the other Gospels had been written. So the timeline is adding up to what church tradition tells us and to what scholarly studies and endeavors tell us. And a large crowd was following him because they saw the signs that he was doing on the sick. All right, at this point, there's a large crowd following Jesus because of the miracles he is doing in healing the sick. But this means that not everyone was following him because of genuine faith, but because what they might get to see him do, or even because what they thought they might be able to get from him. And we see this today. There's a lot of people who attend church, not because they have faith in Jesus, but I get stuff out of it. Maybe I get friends. Maybe if I'm having a hard time, they'll write me a check. Not everybody's like that, but there are people who do attend church, not for Jesus, but for the benefits. And we see a large part of this crowd was not following Jesus for Jesus. They were following him for the benefits. Jesus went up on the mountain, and there he sat down with his disciples. This was to take a break from all of his ministry. Jesus goes up to a mountain, and the word mountain actually means hill country. Doesn't mean he went up on a large peak. And this hill country was close to the Sea of Galilee, still there today. Jesus leaves the crowd to go sit down with his disciples, and now they are in the hill country overlooking the Sea of Galilee. Now the Passover, the feast of the Jews, was at hand. Okay, this is the only Passover in which Jesus was not in Jerusalem. Now it was for sure a requirement that men made the pilgrimage to Jerusalem for Passover, but there was dispute amongst Jewish scholars as to whether that meant every year or a minimum of once in a lifetime. But even as a kid, Jesus' family made the pilgrimage every year. So Jesus not being in Jerusalem for this Passover is a break from the normal pattern of Jesus' life. And it's because of three reasons. One, Jesus had been rejected by the religious elite there in Jerusalem at his last pilgrimage to Jerusalem for a feast just 6 months earlier. Two, the feast was really no longer done in relationship to God to glorify God, but it was done so that the religious elite could glorify each other. And three, Jesus had work to do in keeping with the Father's will right here in Galilee. So lifting up his eyes then and seeing that a large crowd was coming toward him, Jesus said to Philip, "Where are we to buy bread so that these people may eat?" Jesus had just left the crowd trying to take a break with his disciples. And I don't know about you, but have you ever gotten home and then a work phone call comes in? That's when some of our favorite vocabulary comes out, right? Stuff that's not appropriate for the pulpit. You're supposed to laugh at that one. Now I think you guys all think I'm a major sinner, which I am. but you think you're done with work, and it can be frustrating when people call you to try to get you to handle work when you're at home relaxing. It can be annoying. It can make us upset at those people who need our help. But Jesus, taking a break, sees this huge crowd coming towards him, which, by the way, was about 20,000 people. And I'll explain that in a minute. Talk about a lot of work. I'm on break, and I got 20,000 work phone calls to deal with. And what was his response? It was one of compassion. He asks the apostle Philip, "Where can we buy bread for these people to feed them?" And he asks Philip because this is where Philip grew up. This is his home turf. Philip knows this area, but also, verse 6, he said this to test him, for he himself knew what he would do. Philip answered him, 200 denarii worth of bread would not be enough for each of them to get a little. Pragmatic Philip says, Jesus, are you crazy? Not even 8 months' worth of the average day's wage would feed this large crowd. But Jesus is about to teach Philip that where there is little resource but God is involved, there is actually abundant resource. One of his disciples, Andrew, Simon Peter's brother, said to him, "There is a boy here who has 5 barley loaves and 2 fish, but what are they for so many?" All right, so another pragmatic disciple pipes up. Andrew says, "Hey, we got a little bit of food here from this little boy, but yeah, it's not going to be enough." And both of these guys are thinking purely in the physical, not about what God can do. Andrew presents this little boy who has 2 most likely pickled fish. Yum, right? And 5 barley loaves. And by the way, barley loaves were used by the poor because it was much cheaper than the more preferred wheat loaves. But 2 fish and 5 loaves of bread, it's impossible to feed a crowd of this magnitude. And Jesus said, "Have the people sit down." Now there was much grass in the place, so the men sat down, about 5,000 in number. Right, this tiny fraction of resource compared to the size of the crowd. And remember, when they were counting in Hebrew culture, they only counted the men. They did not count the women and the children. So 5,000 men meant about 20,000 people in total. This tiny fraction of resources, it's nothing for 20,000 people, but it does not stop Jesus from doing his thing because Jesus knows what the disciples are still trying to learn. And that is, with God, anything is possible. So he directs this crowd with whom he is having compassion on to sit in a grassy place. Now, grass near the Sea of Galilee is hard to come by, which tells us something about Jesus. He knew this crowd was going to come to him. So when he set set himself down, he'd already picked a place that was going to be comfortable for them. Even before they got there, God is setting the plans in motion for this crowd to be abundantly provided for, even though there is little physical resource present. Then Jesus took the loaves, and when he had given thanks, he distributed them to those who were seated, so also the fish, as much as they wanted. Jesus, knowing this, that he's going to do this miracle, knowing that he is God, the Son, in the flesh, still gives thanks to the Father for his provision and blesses the bread. And that's a good example for us. Always be thankful. Look, Jesus could have complained, "Well, Father, we've only got 2 fish and 5 loaves, and I'm God, but what are you going to do about it?" He didn't. He gave thanks for what God had provided. 2 measly fish and 5 loaves for 20,000 people. Jesus blesses the bread. He starts distributing that little bread and that little fish, and it became as much as they wanted. But there had literally not been enough food. But Jesus, being the sustainer and creator of life, this shows his awesome power to create something out of nothing. 20,000 people were fed with what started out as 2 pickled fish and 5 small loaves of bread. And I just came up with a great Christmas present for y'all. I'm going to get everybody some pickled fish, and I don't want to hear any complaints. You better be thankful about it. This was astonishing. God took what little resource there was and provided abundantly for 20,000 people. That's amazing. And for those who might try to say, "Oh, that just means that everyone took out their picnic baskets and they started sharing food," you're wrong, because of what is going to happen next. And when they had eaten their fill, he told his disciples, "Gather up the leftover fragments that nothing may be lost." We might live in that kind of culture that has that much leftovers, but in a culture where your every day was making food happen through farming and gathering, there is no way they would be gathering leftovers, and there is no way the crowd would be okay with the disciples taking their personal leftovers. It would not happen. So they gathered them up and filled 12 baskets with fragments from the 5 barley loaves left to those who had eaten. And what does that teach us? They gathered up the leftovers. It teaches us not to waste God's resources. Yes, God is a God of abundant provision, and even God himself in the flesh gathered up the leftover resources. So neither should we be wasteful. But I'm going to add a caveat to that. There are some people who believe this means to never throw anything away. And the point is, where even with the best of intentions, some resources outlive their usefulness to God's kingdom. We don't use the same Sunday school curriculum we used in the 1940s for our children because the modern culture is not going to understand what was effective for that time period's culture. It's like if you have leftover food and you try to give as much of it away as you can't possibly eat it all. It does eventually spoil. So this doesn't mean to hoard all the possible resources, right, for the just in case, for the rainy day, or even for the nostalgia of times past, but it means that we use the resources we have to the best of our ability, and we be wise, not wasteful. Be wise. Sometimes the resources we think we have are not the resources God is using. Be wise about that. Pray about it. It's okay to clean out your house. It's okay to throw away something that's been at the church for 60 years. Okay? Although I try to do it secretly. And ultimately, what this part of Scripture shows us is that God is abundantly giving. He's an abundantly giving God. He has given us creation. And here in Western culture, we have been given each much more than much of the world. But that also means we have a responsibility in being wise with God's resources. It means that what he has given us, we should invest into his kingdom. The goal is when God gives us resources, we invest it back into his kingdom so that we see more people put faith in Jesus for the forgiveness of sins. Now, it does not mean that you have to give everything away, but it does mean how are you using what you have for God's kingdom? How are you using your home to invest in God's kingdom? How are you using your car, your money, your time, your stuff, even your hobbies to invest in God's kingdom? How are you using your money to invest in God's kingdom? Oh, I said that, sorry. If you invest in God's kingdom, there is always a guaranteed return on investment. And no, it's not like the stock market where you put a little bit of money in and if you're wise about it, you get like 2% coming back all the time. And if you do this over the course of your life, you can finally retire as a one millionaire. It's not like that. Investing in God's kingdom guarantees a return on investment. And that return on investment lasts for eternity and it doesn't get taxed. Thank goodness, right? But it's in the things that we see here even now. Sometimes we see people come to faith in Jesus because of those investments we've made in the kingdom. That's going to last for eternity. Sometimes we see people grow in their relationship with Jesus. That's going to last for eternity. And sometimes we just get to see people blessed. Maybe we paid a bill for them. And maybe that bill might come back, but the blessing God has given you for investing that into that person's life will last for eternity. That's what I'm talking about. Eternal investment of the kingdom is the best ROI any of you could ever dream of. It means that there are more people who begin to abundantly receive eternal life when we invest in God's kingdom, and that's what it's all about, bringing more people, as many people as possible, into relationship with God through faith in Jesus. And Jesus is faithful to abundantly provide relationship with himself. And that relationship with him is better than what we experience here on earth. And think about it. God, who created this creation, that's who we get to be with. And this creation's pretty darn cool. Yet it is still broken by our sin. So what is our time with our creator, God, going to be like when we live in the fullness of his eternal life without the brokenness of sin? Right? What's that going to be like? What's that? How are the return investments going to be on in that? Because in this life, in all of its beauty and all of its amazingness, it's only a whiff of what eternity will be like with Jesus, through Jesus, because of Jesus, the only God who is also our abundant provider. So when we feel unsafe, when we don't feel like we have all the provisions, or when we feel like those circumstances are coming up that are going to be hard, let's be the believers who remember that God is our safety, and in that, he is providing for us for what we truly need in this life, for what he has called us to in this life. And ultimately, as followers of Jesus, that will culminate in the ultimate provision of eternal life. All right, what have we learned so far? We've learned, again, that I have the sense of humor of a 12-year-old. But more importantly, we've learned that Jesus is our safety. In that, he is the only one who can save us from our sin. And in his saving us, he abundantly provides. No, it may not be what we want or even what we think we need. But he does provide for us what he has called us, for what he has called us to in this life. He does that abundantly. But he also provides for our spiritual needs. He provides us with eternal life through his death, burial, and resurrection when we put faith in him for the forgiveness of sins. And he's providing this even though we can do nothing to remove the stain of sin in our own lives. So what does all this mean? Let's think of it this way. One of my favorite movies is Castaway. It's a great movie. Tom Hanks gets to spend time on a tropical island with his best friend, Wilson. That was me describing the movie poorly. Right? Tom Hanks, he survives a plane crash and washes up on a small uninhabited island. There's literally nothing he can do to save himself, so he spends 4 years alone on this small island, growing out his beard and his hair, and it's getting all ratty and gnarly. He has to learn how to survive as far as just living day to day, and he actually eventually becomes proficient in spear fishing. I love the scene in the movie. They keep showing him mess up, right? And he's got the short hair, and then finally they show him throw the fish, or the spear just perfectly nails this giant fish, and he pulls it out of the water, and it close up on his face, and he's got a beard this long, and you know he spent a whole lot of time eating nothing but fruit trying to get that fish. At one point in the movie, he has an infected tooth that he has to knock out with a rock and an ice skate. And then to keep some semblance of sanity, he draws a face on a Wilson brand volleyball and talks to it like it's a person, even getting into arguments with it. But there was actually nothing he could do to rescue himself. Now, when the tide is right, he builds a raft to get off the island in hopes that he will be rescued. And sure, he does do that. He gets off the island, and then he spends several days at sea, even suffering the loss of his dear friend Wilson. And luckily, a boat does show up, and it rescues him. But what would have happened if that boat didn't show up? No matter all the work he had put into it, he would have died at sea. There was actually nothing he could do to ensure his rescue. He could participate in his rescue. He could participate in it by feeding himself. He could participate in it by building a raft. But he couldn't ensure his rescue. Only the boat could ensure his rescue. And luckily, that boat does show up, and he gets rescued. But no matter how hard he had worked, if not for that ship, he would have died. And it's the same for us through Jesus. It doesn't matter what the circumstances of our life is. It doesn't matter how hard we work. We cannot rescue ourselves. We cannot save ourselves, which is why my second point is Jesus rescues us. Jesus rescues us. And in fact, here in the scripture, we're going to see two very dramatic rescues. Ultimately, we need to understand that Jesus rescues us from being dead in our sins when we put faith in him for the forgiveness of sins through what he did in his life, death, and resurrection. Verse 14, when the people saw the sign that he had done, they said, "This is indeed the prophet who has come into the world." All right, last week, we talked about Jesus talking to the religious elite, and one of the witnesses that bared witness to Jesus as God, as the Messiah, was Moses. In Deuteronomy chapter 18, verses 15 through 18, Moses spoke of a prophet that would tell the people all that God wanted them to know, the fullness of God's relationship. And if those people did not listen to that prophet, God would require a reckoning from them. And these people, because of the miracles of Jesus, recognized that Jesus was that prophet, but they still had different ideas than God. They recognized Jesus as the Savior. But listen to this. Perceiving then that they were about to come and take him by force to make him king, Jesus withdrew again to the mountain by himself. Jesus leaving this scene where the people were going to make him king by force, that is an extremely dramatic rescue. Because the people wanted a political savior. They wanted a king who would overturn by violent force the oppression of their Roman rule. So they thought by making Jesus this miracle dude, the physical king, that they would get what they thought they needed and that what they thought they needed provision for. But God in the flesh knew better what they needed, and it wasn't physical rescue, it was spiritual rescue. Jesus wasn't going to sidestep the cross for some political win to go down in history, because that would have left everyone, including us, dead in our sins. So he leaves the crowd. If they made Jesus king, no one would be able to be made right with God and have eternal life abundantly provided. It was rescuing a stubborn and stupid people from themselves, and the same is true today. We need rescue from our sins. We are those same stubborn and stupid people. And the only way to that rescue is faith in Jesus to rescue us. Now, for those of us who may not believe in Jesus, This is the great truth of the gospel. You cannot do anything to rescue yourself. Being a good person by worldly standards still does not measure up to God's standard of perfect holiness. The way that he originally created us until we ruined it and sinned in the garden. And when we understand that truth, it's actually freeing. It frees us from wondering if we're going to make it into heaven. It frees us from having to do all the works to try to make it because we can't do those works anyway. It frees us from the thought of, did I do good enough? No, you can't do good enough. But Jesus in his love has given you Jesus's good enough. And that was his perfect righteousness. When you put faith in Jesus for the forgiveness of sins, you don't have to be perfect with faith in Jesus. In fact, you cannot be perfect, at least not yet. But he doesn't just stop there and say, okay, you're saved. As we recognize what it is that Jesus has done for us, the Holy Spirit actually works to transform us through the process of sanctification and make us more like Jesus. We actually get to experience the progress of eternal life abundantly as Jesus makes us more like himself. Jesus doesn't give us his righteousness and walk away. No, he still helps us to be more like him, but us being more like him has nothing to do with whether we're going to get into heaven or not, because Jesus already took care of that. And it will culminate in no more brokenness of sin when we reach eternity's shore. And for those of us who do believe, who have faith in Jesus, we need to remind ourselves of this freeing truth every day. That Jesus, in his love for us, has given us his righteousness because he wants to have relationship with us. And that relationship with us helps us to grow closer in relationship to him. We need to remind ourselves as believers that when life is both great and bleak, we have been rescued. The rescue we're waiting on has already happened. We're just not living in the fullness of it yet. Verse 16, when evening came, his disciples went down to the sea. They got into a boat and started across to the Sea of Capernaum. Now, we know from the other Gospels that Jesus actually instructed his disciples to go and he would meet them. And Jesus, in this act of telling them to get on the boat, is rescuing them from what the people wanted to do. See, if they had forced Jesus to be their king, they would have given his disciples lofty government positions, which sounds great. But truly, it is not great. They would have still been dead in their sins because Jesus would have not gone to the cross for us. The dramatic rescue that is going on isn't what we're about to read in the next few verses where he stops the storm. It's that he's continuing with his mission to redeem us no matter what the masses think they need. It was now dark and Jesus had not yet come to them. The sea became rough because a strong wind was blowing. Okay, interesting fact, the Sea of Galilee is one of the lowest bodies of water on the earth. The Sea of Galilee, and you can fact check me on this all day long, is 600 feet below sea level. So when different weather patterns come in, I don't know why that's hard to say, it often causes violent storms in this giant landlocked lake. And here's the crazy part, Jesus, as omniscient God in the flesh, knew this storm was coming, and he sent his disciples into it. Why would God send them into danger? Why would he send them into the storm? Sometimes one storm is rescuing us from another much worse storm. Airports, they do this all the time. They leave people stranded at airports because it's much safer than to fly when the weather is bad. Sometimes it feels like we're getting hosed, right? Well, had Jesus not sent the disciples and then the people because they could find the disciples, found Jesus and made him king, the disciples and the whole world would be in a much worse position because there would be no way to have relationship with God. But also, Jesus is teaching us something when he allows us to go through the storms. Listen, when they had rowed about 3 or 4 miles, they saw Jesus walking on the sea and coming near the boat, and they were frightened. They were now directly in the middle of the Sea of Galilee. 4 miles from the shore is in the middle of the big lake. And they were frightened because they saw Jesus coming to them. They know man cannot defy gravity like that. Man cannot walk on top of water, especially when the water is 141 feet deep. Now, the other Gospels tell us they actually thought he was a ghost. And there were many superstitions of ghosts, and ghosts especially at sea, and it meant you were going to die. So these guys are even more scared because they're not just dealing with a storm. Now they think they're seeing a ghost. But he said to them, "It is I. Do not be afraid." Then they were glad to take him into the boat, and immediately the boat was at the land to which they were going. He told them it was him. And when Jesus gets back on the boat as the creator and sustainer of life and of all creation, he immediately moves them to safety. At the time, they had been in the middle of the lake, and Jesus made somehow that boat be transported to immediate safety on shore. It's like light speed from Star Wars. That's how quick it was. And we know from the other Gospels that Peter even tried to walk on the water towards Jesus, but he didn't have enough faith to do it. And that's actually encouraging because, one, Jesus is with us in those storms. He is going through the storms of life with us, and we can know that Jesus is with us and that he's teaching us to depend on him in the middle of the storm. And even when we mess up in the middle of the storm, what does Jesus do? Peter messed up, right? He didn't have enough faith, and he falls in the water. Now, Jesus, help me, I'm drowning. I think of the old cartoons where they start putting the 5, 4, 3, right? Peter messed up a little bit. I know I wouldn't have enough faith to walk on water either, so I'm not going to be too hard on him. But Jesus still got him to safety. And in fact, he pulls him up, they get on the boat, and they're at immediate safety. And Jesus is going to take us to safety. And no, it's never in our preference of timing, because I'm sure had you asked the disciples before they noticed that Jesus was with them, they were probably saying things like, "How could Jesus send us off into this storm?" Or, "I wish Jesus was here. Why is this happening? What have we done wrong? Why is God punishing us?" God wasn't. He was teaching the disciples to depend on him, and he shows up when we need him. Because, surprise, Jesus is fully aware of what is going on with us at all times and is always in the midst of the storm with us. But do we reach for his hand? Do we let him on the boat? Are we truly seeking him and his will in the middle of that storm? Or are we focused on the bad things happening to us because of that storm so that we just get bitter at God, refusing to recognize he might be saving us from a much worse storm? And at the least, in relationship, he is teaching us to depend on him. God is with us in the storm. He is the rescue for us both in this life and as far as eternity is concerned. But I want to shift for just a minute. I'm about to get myself in trouble. A few verses ago, we read that people wanted to make Jesus king by force. They were looking for a political Messiah. And as humans, we can be very strong about our political opinions. And that's not always a bad thing. And in fact, I think that's a good thing. But sometimes we get so strong on our politics that we willingly break relationship with those who think differently than we do politically. And I'm not the guy who is ever going to tell you how to vote or who to vote for. I used to do that, actually. And I realized the only thing I was doing was breaking relationship with people that I cared about, people that God cares about. My point is, the people of Israel were looking for a political hero. And Jesus is so much more than that. To call Jesus just a political hero is an insult. Jesus, he transcends politics. He transcends the political differences we have, because he is so much more important than our broken by sin opinions of how the world should run. And that's down both sides of the political aisle. We cannot, as followers of Jesus, be focused on the political Messiah. And I'm sorry, it does not matter if you vote Republican, Democrat, or Libertarian, or even for the Green Party. We know the world is not going to get better until Jesus returns. The people we vote for are also marred by sin. So don't do what I have done in the past and think if everyone votes the way that I do, we will finally have our political Messiah who makes my life better. Jesus is who makes our life better. We cannot view our relationships through the lens of politics. We actually need to view our relationships through the lens of our faith. You may find it hard to believe, but internationally, if you look at the whole scale of the world, there are faithful Christian Republicans, there are faithful Christian Democrats, there are faithful Christian socialists in Eastern Europe. And in Nepal, the party that helps the Christians the most is the Communist Party. In no way am I saying any of these political parties are better, because they all fall short when it comes to God's standard of holiness. So do not get lost like I have in the past looking for a political Messiah when you have an abundant, life-giving, person-rescuing, sin-defeating, spiritual Savior who is our safety in Jesus Christ, God the Son. Yes, vote your conscience, but voting is not going to save the world. Only Jesus can do that. So let's be the believers who trust in Jesus as our safety, recognize that he has given abundantly and will continue to do so because he rescues us. Let that transform us and make our relationship with God stronger and our relationship with people, no matter their political views, better. Because relationships are the most important thing in our lives. So by way of conclusion, Jesus is our safety. Jesus is the only way to be saved from our sins. And he did that on the cross. So put faith in Jesus for the forgiveness of sins. Jesus provides abundantly. Jesus gives us what we need for the life that he has called us to, and we will get to live in the fullness of his abundance for eternity if we have put faith in him. And Jesus rescues us. Sometimes he is rescuing us from something worse when we endure the storms of life. And in the eternal scheme of things, he is our only rescue from sin. So a couple of questions. First, what are your fears right now? And essentially, what do you not trust God to handle? If he can handle our eternity, he can handle what you are dealing with right now. And he is actively handling it. Sometimes we just don't see him in the midst of the storm. Sometimes he pops up and scares us. But remember, he is there for the storms you have right now and the storms that are coming. Secondly, how are you looking for the Lord to provide for you? Sometimes we're so focused on what we want that we don't see what God is providing. The people in Galilee wanted a political savior, and they didn't recognize that Jesus was doing something so much more important. Do you want earthly comfort or eternal safety? Because that is what Jesus is providing. It's not always earthly comfort, but it is eternal safety when we put faith in him. And do you trust Jesus to be your safety? Have you honestly put faith in Jesus alone for the forgiveness of sins? Jesus said he was the only way to the Father. Is Jesus your safety for eternity? I'd like to invite the worship team to come back up. We're going to transition into communion here. So I'm going to have you guys come up in just a minute and grab communion. But this cup, the wine, the juice, this cracker, this represents the blood and the body. And that blood and body were provided to us so that we could have relationship with Jesus. It was abundantly provided. Jesus went on that cross and provided himself to be the payment for our sins. And when we put faith in that, this cup represents the safety that we have in Jesus, the safety from eternal separation from God. So let's think about this morning. Think about that this morning as we partake in communion together. So at this time, please come up for communion. I'm going to give you the reminder to open the cracker first. I just feel like I always got to do that. I feel like if somebody spills the grape juice, it's my fault because I didn't remind them to open the cracker first. But I'm going to pray. Father, thank you sent Jesus. And Jesus, we thank you that we can gather together and that we can fellowship together by partaking in communion together. And Lord, thank you that this communion represents the provision of your life in payment for our sins. Lord, we thank you that this cup represents the safety that you have provided for us when we put faith in you, the safety that we can be with you for eternity, no matter what happens here in the temporary. And Lord, we thank you that this cup represents your dramatic rescue of us. Father, remind us of these things every day, not just on Sundays, not just on communion Sundays, every day and every moment. Help us to remember the safety, the provision, and the rescue that you have given freely to us when we have put faith in you. I pray this in Jesus' name. For I received from the Lord what I also delivered to you, that the Lord Jesus, on the night he was betrayed, took bread. And when he had given thanks, he broke it and said, "This is my body, which is for you. Do this in remembrance of me." Let's eat. In the same way, also he took the cup after supper, saying, "This cup is the new covenant in my blood. Do this as often as you drink it in remembrance of me." Just drink. For as often as you eat this bread and drink the cup, you proclaim the Lord's death until he comes. Again, Lord, we thank you so much. We thank you that you have provided for us a safety, a rescue, and even provision for what we need, both physically and spiritually. I'm just so humbled right now in thinking about what it is that you have done for us, Lord. Help us to hang on to that feeling of humility and knowing that we're not God. We can't rescue ourselves, but you did it for us out of your love for us. We give this all to you, and we pray this in Jesus' name. Amen. Please stand as we sing one last song. Torn and beaten, left without reason to move on. Then you reached down and brought me up from the valley of dry bones. You are the God that saved. You're the one that rescues me. You rescue me. You are the God that saves. And you call me from the grave. You rescue me. Ransomed out of the wreckage, pulled from the ashes of sin's hole. Hope is flowing through these veins, life born from grace, grace alone. You are the God that saves. You're the one that rescues me. You rescue me. You are the God that saves, and you call me from the grave. You rescue me. I hear the song, I hear the song of victory ring over me. I hear the song, I hear the song of victory ring over me. I hear the song, I hear the song of victory ring over me. I hear the song, I hear the song of victory ring over me. You are the God that saves. You're the one that rescues me. You rescue me. You are the God that saves. You call me from the grave. You rescue me. You are the God that saves. And you call me from the grave. You rescue me. You are the God that saves. And you call me from the grave. You rescue me. You rescue me. You rescue me. We do benediction every week, and I know sometimes it can feel a little weird, but the point of the benediction is to encourage each of us, to each other, with the hope that God's word provides us. So please repeat with me Romans 15:13 this morning. May the God of hope fill you with all joy and peace in believing, so that by the power of the Holy Spirit, you may abound in hope. Thank you, Jesus. We love you. Amen. You are dismissed.